The gospel for today comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 20. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called out, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ.
"Come and follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fish for people." Right, that's all I needed. Finally, I get to talk about fishing. I do anyway, don't I? Pretty often. When Jesus said, "I'm going to send you out to fish for people," did he mean that we should actually literally tie a line around people or get them with a hook and drag them into the church? Don't think so. We've never tried that one. I don't think it would be a good idea. But he's using an analogy that there are some similarities between fishing and what he calls us to do in what I said before in the baptism, in making disciples of all people, to win them for Jesus. I think as Christians, it's something for everyone that we can all do. I mean, what do we do when we're fishing? Is we try and attract a fish to be interested in what we present to them enough to bite. What do we do as Christians? Is we try and present our life and something, our life, that's not us, but Jesus who is in us, as something attractive that people might want to go, "I want some of that in my life." And they might be interested enough just to ask some questions. So, to explain to you how excited I am about beginning to talk about fishing, and we're going to use some things that in fishing that are similar to being fishers for people that make a difference. I grew up in Hervey Bay, the south end of the Great Reef, and my dad was in the sports fishing club, and I became what you'd call an absolute fishing nerd. I used to go to bed every night as a teenager, and this is once we'd left there. I used to go to bed every night and read this book, and this book is Grant's Guide to Fishers. Bigger than any Bible I have. I would read this book, and as you can see, it's well worn, and I would learn and be able to tell my friends, much to their disgust, the Latin name of all the fish we were going fishing for that day, every species, and their breeding habits and feeding habits and size limits. So much I was interested in this that when I finished school and about the end of grade 12, I drew up a list of pros and cons for the two things I was considering doing with my life. One was the ordained ministry and the other was marine biology. I was so interested in this sort of thing that I was going to go into marine biology. And I drew up the list of pros and cons, and one of them made more sense than the other in terms of outdoor working environment, probably opportunities for work, pay, all that sort of thing. It made a lot more sense to go into marine biology, so I screwed that up and threw it away and applied to go and become a pastor. Because for me, that's the concept of call. It wasn't just what my head told me was the right thing to do, it's what I felt called to do. Now, Ken von Pine calls fishing an incurable disease. And I think with me, he's right. That was the other. Why do I love fishing so much? Because it's one of the earliest memories I have of the things I used to do with my dad, who's one of my best friends. And whether it was in Hervey Bay or the other place I used to do it, was just out here on von Pine's place on the Condamine. Many early memories of coming back to Dalby and going fishing out on the river. And sometimes we even caught fish. But when you love fishing as much as I do, that doesn't really matter whether you catch fish or not. Anyway, there are a few factors when it comes to fishing that make a difference. And I think the same thing makes a difference in how effective we might be at reaching people for Jesus. One of them is your interest level, which I've already explained. And let me tell you, compared to some people, I am mildly interested in fishing. Compared to some people. They spend every day, you know, every weekend they're out there. And I went out with a guide on a dam once to learn how to use a certain type of lure. His boat, you would not get any change from $100,000 to buy his boat and his outfit. and just said no straight away. No. Anyway, your interest level or dedication. Practice is important. Your equipment. Going to where the fish are is important. And being, I was going to say, knowing the bag limits or size limits and practicing catch and release. That's an important one in fishing. Not so much when it comes to the faith. You know, I think 90% of fishermen catch, 10% of fishermen catch 90% of the fish. They're the ones who are really dedicated. And we have sayings like, you know, everywhere you want to go fishing that's close by, someone else is there. And it's always fished out. If you want to get really good fish, you have to go where no one else goes. And so we have sayings like, you have to do the miles to get the smiles. Things like that. That's the way we tell ourselves that we're not crazy for driving for 2 or 3 days to find fish. Some people grew up mad keen about fishing, though it was in their blood. Some came to it later, and it's the same with the faith. Some people think, I'm going to go and reach people for Jesus, I'm going to convert people to the faith, and they're brought up doing that all their lives. Some of them get into ministries and things later in life. Some of them start their life or only come later. Only are drawn out of the water and into the boat, I suppose you'd say, and then think, right, it's my turn. I think practice is important. When I was, 2 years ago, before I went on a big barramundi fishing trip, now that's, for me, barramundi are the best fish to catch in Australia. It's our Rolls Royce of sports fish. 2 years ago, I was about to go on a big barramundi fishing trip, and if you had watched me in my backyard at Gumbungee, you would think of it. As I was standing there in the backyard, casting a lure into a 44-gallon drum. Now, I knew there were no fish in that 44-gallon drum. That's not the point. But sometimes when you're fishing for barra, they hide behind a tree or a log or a rock, and you have to get a ledge. You have to get your lure in just the right place, as in a rubbish bin lid from 30 or 40 metres away, the length of a cricket pitch at least, and you have to try and get it into something the size of a rubbish bin lid. Miss by that much, and they might not be interested, and it makes a difference between coming home with a story or coming home with a fish photo. I can't fish every day, much to my frustration. I can't fish every day. When you finish work at night and you only got a few hours, you can't get 2 hours away to a dam, and that's about the closest one here. And so you've got to find something else to do. And I'll be down there in the shed tinkering with gear and, you know, making sure the boat's ready to go and greasing the bearings and, you know, retightening all my knots and that sort of thing. And that sort of thing makes a difference. I think practice and that attention to detail is important. Equipment's an interesting one. When you go fishing, some people use thousands of dollars worth of equipment like that boat I was talking about. And I've seen some people be successful. In fact, as a kid, one of the most successful things I remember was coming back to Grandma and Granddad's place here in Hayden Street in Dalby, where Granddad had an insulator off an old power line with a bit of a stake sticking down from it. He had some old fishing line, a spark plug tied to it for a sinker, and then a hook on the end of that, and we'd get worms out of Grandma's chook pen, put them on there, and throw them in the mile out behind my Granddad. And some years we caught fish. Sometimes we didn't, but then again, we were kids who cared. So there's such a difference between thousands of dollars worth of equipment or just a bit of line wrapped around an old insulator. You don't have to have the very best gear or the very best training or everything to be able to get out and enjoy it. And I think it's the same with faith attractive to people, to being hopefully telling people about Jesus. You don't have to have to do every training course without it. Do a lot of things. It's going on and off. I'm going to go up there like James did because I worked out at the start of the service that you can bang on that and it makes a great noise. So I should do that for sermons. Can you follow me with the camera? Sorry, Lois. Didn't mean to do that to you. Let's turn this off. Right. Now, before I had my boat, I used to fish from a kayak. And kayaks are great. They're really portable. You put it on top of the car, you take it anywhere. But on my kayak that some people used to laugh at, I had a fish finder. I had the electronics built into my kayak.
You could remove the top bit, but the transducer and all was underneath. And everyone, you can tell someone who doesn't know anything about fishing, because what do they always say when they hear you've got a fish finder? That's cheating. Everyone says that to me. Oh, that's cheating. I say, well, if it's such good cheating, how come I still come home with no fish so often? You think if you were going to cheat, you'd do it in a way that would help you. But there is an awful lot of water out there between the fish, and there are a lot of places where the fish aren't. We have to go to where the fish are. And I know some guys who will not put a lure or a bait in the water for hours until they see at least five fish on their sounder. Because otherwise they'll just be sitting there for hours with nothing happening, getting frustrated. Do you see that sometimes in the way churches work, that we will sometimes try and work where there are no fish? We will put churches where there are no people or where there used to be people. You have to go where the people are. My father, who was a retired pastor, once had a woman say to him that the church is the workplace of the Holy Spirit. Lovely thing to say, isn't it? And she said, and the pub is the workplace of the devil. And he said, no, it's the other way round. And he's right. As in, when I'm out fishing, if I've caught a few fish and I've put them in my esky or my fish keeper, do I then go and fish in there because I know there's fish there? You don't want to catch the same ones again. You want to be out getting other ones. You want to go to where the fish are and get them. Dad had to explain to this lady that where she thinks was such a terrible place, like the pub, not that it's a bad place, go there for a meal or for a few beers, that's where the people are. And you know what? That's exactly where Jesus would have been, in amongst normal everyday people. That is where fishing for people can be so important. When I was about 7 years old, I was fishing with Dad out on the Condamine here, and we came back and Granddad looked at one of the fish we'd bought and he said, oh, that's a bit little. And I remember my grandfather saying, he was working in his shed, and in his grand way that Granddad used to say things, he said, if there's fishing in heaven, I hope God makes me the fishing warden. And I think Granddad's probably a little bit out of luck. I'll let you do that. Because God's kingdom has no rules about catch and release, as I said. When you go fishing, you need to know the size limits. You can't keep any that are too small. You need to know the bag limits. In other words, you can't have too many, just so that it's sustainable. But what do I love about having the baptism this morning? You can see that there's no size limit on bringing people into God's kingdom. God wants the tiddlers as well as the big ones. And there's no bag limit. There's always room for one more in God's kingdom. I love technology. Sounds like it's working. Right. I'm staying here though. My ambition when I was growing up was to catch a barramundi. Just one. One day I'm going to catch a barra. Right? And I thought it was impossible. I'll never get one of those. They're like the highest thing. Not that I'm bragging or anything, but I reckon I'm up to about 12 barra so far. And my biggest is 85 centimetres. I'm always trying to beat that. But you know, it was impossible. I couldn't imagine how I could do it until I did it and got one. And you live off that. The memory of that, you live off it, and you think, you get confidence out of it, and you think, I can do this. How often do we see people brought to the faith in churches? Often it's hard. You don't see adults come to the faith as often as you'd like. But you can start to think, is this ever going to happen? Do we take people who don't know about Jesus and are they converted to the faith? Are they saved? But I have seen it. You know, it does happen. And let me tell you, again, you live off it. You need to say, hey, this is possible. We don't think it is until we see it, but when it does, it's such a joyful thing when we see it. Why are so many people love the idea of fishing but hate the idea of being fishers for people, fishers of men? Is it fear that we might get it wrong? I mean, the amount of times I come home with no fish, and that's a lot of times, just makes me enjoy the times more when I do get one or two. Are we worried about failing? If we never try, isn't that more of a failure? What I brought this rod in is, and I think it works perfectly for today,
is because some of you may know my story of woe from this last year, of going fishing with a couple of mates in August, and my dad was there, and we were on a houseboat on Lake Mondurin up near Gingin. And we were jigging for barramundi straight under the boat, about 12 foot under the boat, with a kind of lure that just bounces up and down off the bottom. And we'd been there. It had been a cold snap. You know, you always need an excuse as to why you're not catching fish. We'd only got one or two, and we were getting a bit, we're not going to catch a fish. And we're sitting there, and Dad was just jigging like this and holding the rod on top of his hands. Not this rod, my favourite rod and reel. Just holding it on top of his hands like this, bouncing it away, and a barramundi came from under the boat and hit that lure so hard that Dad, the one second the rod was in Dad's hand like that, and the next minute it was gone, just boom, straight out into the water. And Dad looked at me and dived straight overboard. And I think that scared me more than the fishing rod. And he tried to go and get it, and I saw it get dragged away from his hand, and he almost got it, but it was gone. Gone. My favorite. Now, to his credit, he paid me back for that, and I've since gone and bought new and better gear, so that's good, that's okay. But this one I bought because I'm determined to catch a barramundi with this rod and reel. The reason for this is because this one I pulled out of a dam when I was fishing for something else. I was up at Lake Bunduma, and I was fishing with a jig on the bottom and bouncing it along, and I went, uh-oh, I've got a snag, I'm going to lose this lure. And then I thought, no, hang on, it's moving, whatever it is, and I brought it to the surface, and this rod and reel came up. Don't know how long it had been there. I'm hoping whoever sees this on video doesn't say it's mine and claim it. The good thing about coming out of fresh water is that it was not rusted, it was just covered in mud and stuff like that. And I cleaned it up, I took the reel apart, put new bearings in it, put new line on it, and I'm determined to catch a fish on this one because this is, I call this one Moses, because Moses means I drew him out of the water. And I think it's a wonderful image for who we are and how we are in God, and especially with Theo's baptism this morning, that all of us are ones who God drew out of the water and then sends to go out and fish for people, like this rod. I drew it out of the water and I'm going to use it to catch a big fish. God draws all of us out of the waters of our baptism, gives us new life, and then sends us out to fish for people. So I think that's a great image. And I just love the idea of walking down the road on a Sunday morning with my fishing rod and seeing the looks that I would get from people. Jesus calls us, come follow me. They're his fish, it's his water, it's his world, he's our guide. So I pray that you come to love fishing, even if it's not this sort of fishing, as much as I do, and that you might be better at it than I am too. It's a lifetime pursuit. Have anyone ever heard the fisherman's prayer? There's a few different fisherman's prayers. The first two lines of what I'm going to pray are the fisherman's prayer, and then I've added two lines to it. So you can have a laugh after the first two lines, that's okay. And it goes, let's pray. It goes, Dear Lord, let me catch a fish so big that even I, when speaking of it afterwards, will have no need to lie. But when the time has come to fish for men, help me to do the best I can so many more might be in the boat with you. Amen.